Check, check. Let's get that bass down a little bit.
I was gonna say, this
bass probably not. Oh my goodness. I don't know if it was just me, but it's our first time we got this subwoofer. It's a subwoofer, James? Jeez. I'm sitting over there, my ears are buzzing. Anyone else feel that?
No, I love it.
No,
it was good. It's so hard to tell how it sounds out there, right?
It sounded good. It
sounded
good.
Yeah.
And then all those coffee, it sounded.
We're becoming one of those modern, progressive, hipster churches, right?
Yay.
Drinking coffee because I'm totally lacking sleep. Lacking good sleep. Hallelujah. Let's pray. King Jesus, we just love you this morning. And we just humble ourselves before you. Lord, we just want to please you. You've done so much for us, God. And, I mean, you created us and you're our dad. And we totally screwed up. You sent your son Jesus to pay the full price of sin that we could go free. We just thank you for freedom in this room, in this church. We just bless all the children this morning in the surrounding rooms in this building. Just pour your spirit on our children, Lord. Pour your spirit. Show them your heart, Daddy. Thank you, Father. We love you. We just thank you that today, Lord, I just pray for just a grace to share and a grace to receive. And just a peace to come over hearts and minds. Amen. Well, my name is Josh, if I haven't met you before. Come on, first up, Jim. We'll do one at a time. We'll do both. We'll do a reverse Oreo cookie. Do they have those?
You do now.
Yeah, we do now.
So this is my good friend Joel Witten and Jermaine Ransom, and they're from the Toronto area. And I've been walking with these guys, and we've been friends for over 10 years, and doing ministry together. You came to the cottage one year, we hung out, watched baseball, and went for a run, and you showed me how out of shape I am, and we're still feel like that, so he's like, come on, man, keep up, and I'm like, oh, I just died. But Joel, just wanted you guys to take a minute and just share anything that's on your heart, and what you saw this weekend, kind of even prophetically, maybe what you see over this house, and just take a minute and just share.
Cool. How's everyone doing this morning?
Great.
Yeah, some people are tired. I would have expected that to be a male's voice from the men's encounter. We had a great weekend. Man, it's like Josh said, I've known Josh probably at least for the last 10, maybe 12 years. I met Josh in Oshawa. I think the first time I met Josh was at one of my, a small group I was leading. And I remember Josh had come with someone, and then he was outside, and he had found someone across the street before he came to the connection group. So my first visual of Josh is him ministering to someone. Anybody else ever had that visual of Josh? Anybody in this place? Across the street before he came into my small group, and we've been friends ever since. And so it's a privilege to be here with you. Me and Jermaine had started an organization this year. That's sort of really looking to go into schools, go into community centers, and really covert ministry. We can say it here, it's not being taped. You know, it's covert ministry. It's an organization that speaks on mental health and bullying and healthy relationships. But wherever we can, I mean, it's been really, really cool, the doors that God's been opening up for us, just in terms of even the people that we're connecting with. Because I'm a pastor at heart. I worked with Josh's pastor and my pastor, who's my brother, Pastor Brendan, for 7 years full-time in the church, but then God's called me outside of the four walls now. Anybody else feeling called outside of the four walls? That's a place God's always wanted his church to be. So I'm happy to be there, but still have that pastoral heart. So we're out there and we'll be connecting with somebody. And it's so cool because we're finding more and more just starting to realize the full purpose for why God has us out there. So it's obviously this generation, this youth, we're really looking to create a culture that kids can, you know, sort of extend essentially kingdom culture and have kids a safe place for kids to really find themselves and to grow in their identity and to find God. But all the people that we're connecting with, we're really finding that they're, like, say, the program manager at the community center, who's an old friend, his needs are so great. And then God connects us with somebody who's getting us into schools, but then the guy who's connecting us with the schools, his needs are so great. And we're just getting to minister on every level, so it's really, really cool. This weekend, man, Encounters is something that we've had the privilege of knowing about and being a part of with our church and even being down here a couple times. I don't know if anybody, who's been part of Dunamis from the start?
Pretty close?
So you may recognize my face underneath this beard. I don't know, I got a little bit of a disguise on, but I've had the privilege of being down here a couple of times. And just every time God shows up, it's without fail, the change that you get to be a part of in a 24-hour period, really, because it's by Saturday night. It goes till Sunday morning sometimes, but by Saturday night, the countenance change you see in individuals. The extreme change. I've said it many times that I've watched people get more in a 24-hour period than some people get in a whole lifetime of church, just because of the simple process that we walk through in the encounters of systematically going through it, systematically set up to go through the Word and apply God's truth, hear His truth, shine His light on each area of your life, and then choose to align yourself with that. Choose to make the decisions you need to in your own heart to agree with that. And then you see what happens. And it's just without fail, it's John 8:31, when you talk about it on the weekend, Jesus said to those who believed in Him. So, those who are believers, not the end game, that's just the starting point. If those who believed in Him, He said, if you continue in My Word, meaning if you don't just hear it, but you actually apply it, you actually do it, and then you continue in it, then you are truly My disciples. And that's what He's looking for. That's what He's called each one of us to be, is to be disciples. And if you continue in My Word, then you're truly My disciples, and you will know the truth. And that's not just an intellectual knowledge, like we've grown up in a system that's really come from the Greek background, which is we're really big on intellect. We're really big on knowing things. Oh, I heard that passage before. I heard that concept before. I know that already. But that's not enough. This is an experiential knowledge talking about. The word's gnosko in the Hebrew, and it's like to experience. If you continue My Word, then you will experience the truth, and that truth that you experience will set you free. And we watch it. We watched it this weekend. I wish you could have been there if you weren't there. We're really thankful for those ladies that were up preparing the food. I don't know, let's give them a hand. There was some anointing going on in that kitchen, because even that first night, it was like 12 at night, and they asked me if I wanted soup, and it's like, sure, I had some soup, and we brought up this potato bacon, like, deliciousness. It was great. But thank you so much for that, really serving this weekend. But yeah, just, we got to see what God does every single time. He's so faithful. Amen. He's so faithful. I'm looking forward to hearing some of these testimonies, and it's a privilege to be here with you guys, and God bless you.
Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning, family.
I've always thought Jermaine was a very good-looking man. So I thought he was still single. I was actually going to make a pitch, a story, because he's my age, right? And I'm like, this dude's still single. How are you still single? And then I found out he's been married for the last 2 years. And all the single ladies go, aww.
But Joel is single.
Joel is single. Joel is still single.
Josh didn't come over and grab the mic to say that he always thought I was a good-looking dad.
So you saw a lot of that this weekend. It's just family. And shout-outs to, shout-outs to everyone, you know. And you guys just made us feel so welcome and accepted and loved. And shout-out to John. Shout-out to Vaughn. Shout-out to Devon. Where's Don? I wanted to do that, so I got it. Shout out to Ron, wherever he is in his room. I'm just throwing out to Ron. No, it was cool. It was family. It was family. And whenever we do encounters, the counter mantra is we connect with God, we connect with each other, and he's in the third one. And like we came with ourselves, obviously, right? So we connected with God. We connected. It just such an openness to family. So just thank you so much for just taking both of us in and making you us part of the family. We know that conceptually as Christians, yeah. You know, we're the body of Christ, but it can be so big and corporate and just kind of conceptual. But then we have opportunities like this become. So the weekend was awesome. It was amazing. People got set free. Sons became more sons, stepped into to their calling, their purpose, and it was just such a blessing. So you guys are so blessed. What you have here is such a precious thing. Just let me talk. Tell them what you felt when you first felt. Tell them what did I feel. We felt the presence of God, and it was awesome because again, like we're the prophetic, and we're living a time where the gifts of the Spirit and the prophetic and all of that's very kind of more of a seeker sensitive kind of. We don't want to offend anybody. You guys are just full out. The ladies in the kitchen. It was my first time here, so I mean they're cooking in the back, and then they. We did the Holy Spirit session. Came just praying over me, and I'm there just blessing people, and then they say, go get him. And I'm like, no, I'm here to minister. And then I just get hit over, and I'm on the ground. And I said, come on, get more, give me more. You know, praise God. So we love you guys. You're in our hearts. Thank you so much. Just round of applause to everyone, really. You guys are awesome. So we're going to be, after service, we'll be around for a little bit. So if you want to talk, chat. Connect where we're here. We love you guys. Oh, and your pastor. Your pastor.
Come on. Give it up. Yeah.
Oh my goodness. Your pastor. I know you guys don't have a issue with honor. I've seen how you guys treated your pastor this weekend. You love him. And it's an interesting thing because as a leader or as a pastor, their duty and responsibility is to lead from the front, but sometimes they need encouragement themselves because they're spearheading stuff in the spirit. They're going out there, they're trying to hear from God the best they can, and Josh did such an amazing job directing everything over this weekend. It was just so spirit-filled, it was so spirit-led, it was so encouraging. Just the heart of God is just all over him. Even how you can have a very preacher mentality when it comes to doing like an encounter weekend, I'm here to have my notes and so on and so forth, but so sensitive to the spirit, such a servant heart. Like this one time Josh was just little nuances that I caught. Josh was, he was speaking, and then someone was kind of wrestling with their chair, and he goes, hey, we can get you a chair in the back if you want. I'll be a little bit more comfortable. We can switch the chair. And I was just like, man, that's such a pastor, you know? He's in the middle of dropping a hot word, and then he's just like, we can switch the chair, make you feel more comfortable. So when you have an opportunity, just bless him. Take him out to lunch, you know? Bless him and his wife and his family, encourage him. He's such an awesome, precious gift.
Pay him to say that. Let's pray for you guys. Stretch your hands. So, Mark, if you want to come up for a moment. And these guys just spearheading a ministry. If anyone felt led just to give them some money, I always do that with our guests that we bring. Just give them cash, give them 20, give them 100 bucks, 200 bucks, whatever you feel, whatever God said, $5, give them a toonie for the coffee on the way home, whatever. Just bless these guys. Father, we just thank you for. Jermaine and Joel, and we just bless them, we bless their ministry, and Lord, just for what they poured out, we just thank you for the gift of their lives, we just receive it. And Lord, just bless them as they go. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Very cool.
All right. So yeah, who here knows that Jesus is in the business of changing lives?
Amen.
My friends Tim and Carol as well, they're here from Mattawa, and I keep telling them they need to move to Sarnia. And but anyway, as the Lord leads them, but it may never happen. But I love them, and hopefully we can hang out in Florida this year. Anyway. Jesus is in the business of changing lives. That's what he loves to do. That's why he came. And he came to set us free, not just to set us free from sin, and not just to take away our sin nature, but he came to empower us to be like him.
Yeah.
That's why he came. And so I have a love, hate, not hate, because hate is too strong a word, but a love.
Dislike.
Challenge relationship with encounters, because every time, like if you go to lead an encounter, you would find this if you even just launched out to lead a cell group or something like that. Whenever you're going, even getting up to preach or something, you have to die to yourself, because you have to realize it's not about me. God knows very clearly if he spoke to me and said, lay down the church, it's not about me. It's not about personality. It's not about gifting. It's about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It's always going to be about Jesus. I'll take that as a confirmation. That's how I felt Friday afternoon when I was preparing. Because it's like, wife and I are fighting. We're fighting all week, and it's all my fault. It's always a man's fault.
You were doing good until the last one.
But she's not here, so I can say that. Nobody go out and tell her, hey, do you want to talk about you again? Spend more time. All right.
Is this going live?
But the reality is, the thing, the challenge about encounter, the challenge about church, the challenge about Jesus is you have to die to live. Yeah. The beautiful thing about Encounter Weekend is you're kind of boxed in, right? You don't really know what you're getting into exactly until you're there and God just puts you in a Holy Ghost pressure cooker.
Yeah.
And then you're forced. You're either going to die to sin and be raised up to a new level in the life and resurrection life of Jesus, or you're gonna run. We've had people just call their moms to pick them up. They're like, I can't do this. Yeah. Okay, Don called his mom. Justin called his mom. Oh, you're kidding, mom comes in. When you first get there, and we saw, because by and large, right, Canadians, especially even more so than America, I think, but Canadians, a lot of our nation is bound by very kind of like modest, there's a cap over their personality where they don't want to really let themselves out for fear of offending someone.
Yeah.
And the thing about Jesus, when you really get the hold of your life, is he says, just be yourself, man. Be yourself. Be your redeemed self.
Yes.
Right? But in the fullness of your personality, one of the books, and I encourage every man to get it if you haven't, but it's a book, Wild at Heart. I read it when I was 18 years old. And the statement that rings in my heart, my spirit constantly, even to this day, 16 years later, is let people feel the weight of who you are.
Amen.
Because the world needs your strength.
Yeah. Wow.
So we're talking about men and women. We need to be freed up to be ourselves. Our redeemed, resurrected nature, ourselves. And in order to do that, we need to die to sin. So, there was a lot of that going on. And one of the reasons I love Encounters is because it forces me to die again. And it forces our leadership team to die again. And then it forces all the participants, whether they know it or not, if it's their first time, they're like, oh. That's why people are like, I've already been on Encounter. You know what they're saying? I went, I died, I resurrected all the dead stuff in my life, and I do not want to go back for round two.
I'll agree to that.
Not always, but so often. And so, just want to take some testimonies this morning of some people that really felt like, man, God just, He did a work in me. So, amen. Who wants to go first? Devon. All right. So I'm gonna keep it. Yeah, give this guy a hand clap. Now, you're part of our leadership, but so I know that you're a preacher, so I'm gonna hold the mic.
That's okay.
Otherwise, we're gonna be here till 12:30, even though it's only 11 o'clock right now. So
that's okay.
Clock didn't get changed back yet.
I came from a background we could do a 2-hour sermon, so I would just chill for a little bit, let you hold, like, because I don't want to drop it either. This was an awesome weekend.
Yeah.
I thank God for our guests. I thank God for my brothers. I thank God for my pastor. But most of all, I thank God for change. Because that's what I went in this weekend for, change. It's been a blessed year for me so far. And one of the biggest things is that I had a brother, Thomas Kavanaugh, say to me at near the beginning of the year, by this time next year, you'll be a different man. So I've been like, okay, Lord, what are you doing? What are you doing? And He's been just like whittling away at all of the excess stuff. And it's been hard some days, but it's been a blessing other days. And this weekend was really cool because I went in there a little bit shell-shocked because I'm like, man, it's not roughing it really. I mean, realistically, roughing it, we lived out in BC, my wife and I, and roughing it for us was taking the tent and going sitting and having deers walk across our campground and listening to beer scratch the trees. But this was a little bit like out of my comfort zone because I got me snoring and then I got up and I heard other guys snoring and it just sounded like a whole bunch of trucks driving down the highway.
We did provide earplugs.
Oh yeah,
by everyone.
But also it's like we had this opportunity to tap into the Holy Spirit that I didn't think I was ready for. I really didn't think I was ready for. You know, we even had like, from the beginning, as a part of the leadership team, Josh said, we're gonna roar. And I was like, okay, we're gonna roar. One,
before the encounter began.
One, two, and I felt like I was gonna give up. But I remember Josh saying, you know, and I think it was Jermaine who said, make sure it comes from down here.
Yeah.
I remember roaring and I'm like, man, Lord, you're on it right now. You are on it right now. And the first thing that came back to my mind is like, I have this this poem from Muhammad Ali because he's one of my heroes growing up. And it's like, I done handcuff lightning and I throw thunder in the jail. I know I'm bad. Just last week I murdered a rock, injured a stone, hospitalized a brick. I'm so mean I make medicine sick. And then he added, float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. Rumble, young man, rumble. Roar! So I thought to myself, you know, I'm so mean I make the devil quiver.
Amen.
I'm so strong I make demons hide. I am so powerful that I can change this world because my God has my back. And this weekend has proven a lot to me. And I am grateful. I am so grateful to have a man of God leading my church. I am so grateful to have a band of brothers that can keep me accountable. So, when Don and Vaughn and Devon starts rocking out in his church, and John, now we need a Ron.
Don right here.
When we start rocking out this church, I know God is going to be leading us.
All right, who's next? I'll come to you.
Yeah, I got a face to feed. And you let me hold the mic. I just want to say,
what?
I was.
I know he's going to be 30 seconds, okay? Okay, I'll hold it so Devon doesn't feel bad.
Okay, anyhow, as a participant and a helper. And I just want to say, I've gone to 6 of them in the past. There's always more.
Yeah.
When you think you've got it all, oh, wait, there's more.
Amen. Thank you. All right, let's get one of the participants up. There we go.
Come on.
Can you hear me here? I am so overwhelmed with God's blessing. I was thinking about it this morning. I got a big hug from the Father. I got infused by the Holy Spirit. And I got a cleansing from Jesus. And it was an amazing, amazing time. And I want to honor the leadership. You guys have ministered so well. I've been in a lot of conferences. I've traveled a lot in missions. But the Holy Spirit was so welcome and so honored throughout this weekend. And it was so powerful. And I just want to honor you guys. Thank you so much for being obedient and making us feel so welcomed and so loved in this place. God bless you.
Amen. I was saying to Don and Devon earlier, could you imagine if we got every new believer onto a weekend like this? Man, it just would catapult their faith. You know, they thought a weekend like this is probably worth a year of church or more. You know, a year of Sunday morning, a year of worship experiences, a year of sermons, a year of fellowship. I mean, just the expediting processes of the Holy Spirit when you just allow that to happen, right? It's amazing. Yeah, so we do men's encounters and women's encounters. I believe the next women's one will be
upcoming.
I'm being told it's upcoming. And so, where you want to go, eh? Are you guys sisters?
Yeah.
That's cool. Twins?
No, I'm older.
Oh, okay. Who's next? Brandon.
Hey.
Come on.
Yeah, well, when I first went, I felt like, I was like, oh man, I don't even want to talk to people. I just want to, like, smell my like, I've been kind of in a rough spot lately, but just, when it was the father's love session, and we were just sitting there, we were just pretty much just, and, like, I remember someone spoke to me, and he was like, he's like, I think it was, like, something like, he's satisfied with you, and, like, I struggle so much with striving, and just trying to be good enough, and just, like, oh my gosh, you just love me just right now, I don't gotta do anything, I'm just getting rocked. And then just that freed me up just to be me and just talk to people and just not have to, like, feel like I have to do, like, do something, be good enough, and just be me. It just really freed me up. It was awesome.
Yeah. That's so good. Hi there. You know, it took a while for it to hit me. It was Kyle's one on forgiveness that it really I had a lot of built up hate and distrust towards some of the people who have hurt me in the past, and it really felt good to just let that go.
Amen.
So you feel a little level of freedom?
Yes.
It's awesome. There's more for you, man. Come on, give John a hand. Five. Next. So this was by far our youngest participant. You're 13, right? 13. So I was a bit worried about him because some of the content You know, we do a godly sexuality session, and it's you know, it's heavy. And, you know, 99% of it did not pertain to this man, but you know, and the stuff, so I was like a bit worried, and then, but it came to the last sessions, and just seeing how rocked, I mean, you really, well, I'll let you talk.
It was amazing. In the deliverance session, whenever someone put their hand on me after I fell down the first time, I just kept going down. And then...
That would have been the Holy Spirit session.
Yeah. In one of the sessions, I was crying and someone gave me a note. I don't know who it was. Don't really care who it was. Like, I care for the person, but...
Gotcha.
I opened it, I read it. It said, just receive. And then yesterday, I got baptized in a bathtub as well.
Just so you know, I actually counseled against it. I'm like, sure you don't want to wait. Maybe your family wants to see. He's like, no, I need to do this now. Like, who can withhold water from such a one?
And then I knew there was something on the inside of the whole note because it was folded, and I didn't open it until after I was baptized, and it was, I don't remember, I can't hear. It says that you are released from it all.
Wow.
And that obviously ministered to you powerfully. Let's pray for you, Brett. Jermaine, or Joel, one of you guys pop up here, let's pray for this guy. Stretch your hands for Brett. Come on. Holy Spirit, we just thank you for this man. Just bless him. You guys just get him. Just bless him. Bless him. Don't just try and stand. Thank you, Lord. Get you back to your seat. Who's next? Thank you, Jesus. Just get him. Come on up to you, Don. Come on up to you, Don. We're going to pump some of these out quick because we're running out of time. Come on this side. Walter.
So I just want to share with you guys that I totally, I was filled with the Holy Spirit, and I'm still holy with the Holy Spirit right now. And I just gained a lot of self-confidence and self-courage. And man, I look up to this guy. He's only 13. I wish I was baptized when I was 13. And this is so awesome. And just, I thank you, Lord, for just self-confidence. And I'm able to do things within Christ now.
Yeah. Bless you.
I'm Don of the four. As a father, I was thoroughly blessed this weekend to be able to see my two boys receive empowerment by the Holy Spirit and just be filled to unbelievable proportion. And again, in my heart as a father, there's nothing more encouraging and self, I guess, pride for that, not saying that word, but I mean, it really encouraged to see my boys both love the Lord, be there, and want to just receive more of Him. And you know what? As I went in, I really didn't know what to expect, just because, you know, as far as I grew up in a Christian family, I had a father that was present, I had a mother that was present. I have never experienced any abuse in any way, shape, or form. I've never been in a drunken state. I've never used any illegal drugs. So I was thinking, what do I need, God? What are you going to have for me? Because I don't think I'm going to need it.
I'm already righteous.
So, you know, so and again, looking in my life,
I'm just kidding around.
I've been distracted. Looking at my life, you know, I again, growing up in the family I've grown up, you know, we can get busy in everything we do. We can get caught up in work. We can get caught up in organizations we belong to. But you know what? You got to stick close to God, right? Because He is your strength. He is your all. He is your purpose. He's your being. He loves you. He wants more of you. He wants you to give everything to Him. And that's what I realized this weekend. I need to rely solely upon, like I've seen my one son, like give everything totally to God. I got to do that too. You have to do that. You got to give everything to Him. Your marriage, your friends, your parents, your children. Just give them all to Him because He's deserving of them. He wants everything of you. He wants you to be solely reliant upon you to be solely reliant upon Him, okay? And God is love, and bless you guys all for the ministry that you guys are doing here. Thank you for the three, I'll call you stepsisters, that you have a powerful ministry. I mean, I don't go down easy, and man, I had no hope against the three of you, because you just came and boom, it was down we went. And again, thank you for your ministry, and thank you for the ministry of doing this church.
Awesome. Good Lord.
Oh. We're the sons.
So I didn't know these guys were twins until they told me. And I was like, no. But I thought, and I'm like, one of you guys looks like your mom. The other one looks like your dad. Like, you literally take this face, boom. And you take mom's face, boom. And it's like, it's pretty cool. I can't tell which one's better looking. But you guys are both going equally different ways.
I felt we should come up just to be with Dad here too. I thought I knew Jesus. Yeah, I thought I knew Him coming into that, and it was I had things lifted off of me. You know, really just understood the love the Father has for me. I've been experiencing that in my everyday life, but just to understand what the gift of Jesus was, and that was really cool. You know, I got to bond with my father and my brother, and got to see cool things in them, and just, you know, even in myself, God's working every single day. So yeah, I definitely encourage anybody that can get out, or even can't get out, still go. it's encounter is definitely something that everyone needs to experience.
Amen.
On the way to encounter, I wasn't feeling good, and I really didn't want to be there, and I don't know, when I got there,
me neither.
lots of people. Anyways, on encounter the Friday night, we talked about God dying on the cross for us, Jesus dying on the cross for us, and I don't know, I never really thought of it in so much depth, and it really hit me just thinking about it on Friday night, and yeah. And how God loves us so much, and He cares for each and every one of us. So
you got totally blasted on Saturday night. Have you ever been filled or blasted that much before by the presence?
Not whatsoever, no. Yeah. It was an amazing experience.
Why don't we get the three ladies? Seriously. You can have fun in church. We'll get Kyle, Joel, Jermaine, just get behind these guys, just in case. Michelle, Frankie, Andrea. I don't know. Sometimes you just have some moves. Just get these guys. Just bless them. Well, Father, we just thank you for these guys. And, anybody else? Who's coming up next? Come on. What's your name?
My name is Dylan.
A little bit distracted. It's okay. Yeah.
So.
You get your focus here for a moment. I just want to say,
So I was in like ministry in my university, and like I went to large city teams, and I stood up to people, and it was a humbling experience. And then like I just kind of had that my identity, and I I was encouraged by that, and I saw my worth in that. And when I came home from university, it was amazing. Like to have that legacy and have people on my teams know me because of my faith. And then I came and came back to my home. And after 5 years, 25 almost, 26 now living with my parents, that's not a bad thing in this society, I've been blessed. But just having coming back from that, I don't speak to anyone from university, and it was like they saw my worth and it was amazing, but and I just didn't bring it back to my life, and I saw some pretty amazing stuff this weekend, and I saw people just get broken, and I get that it's not a one-time deal, and I knew that going in, and people say things and you you don't know until you just feel God in your life and you just feel him moving, and you know that like you have a destiny that is beyond yourself, and it's not just in one university, it's in this world. And yeah, that's my new, I got prayed for, and literally four people, maybe they were talking beforehand, but four people told me, like, they're like, there's change in your heart, and you're gonna make difference. And it's gonna be
Come on.
This year is going to be new and different for you.
Amazing.
Wow. Amazing. Awesome.
Amazing. Awesome. Andrea, come on. You know, yeah. You know, encounter really is just anything, really, right? It's just a seed. It matters what you do with it. So I was telling young Brett, he got baptized in a bathtub. I got baptized in a hot tub. And I don't care if you get baptized in the Jordan River in Israel. It means nothing if you don't follow Jesus after. It's all about Jesus. It's all about following him today. Right? So you go to encounter, you get freed up to follow Jesus.
Yeah.
You get freed up and you get empowered to follow Jesus today. Because Jesus wants to fellowship with you today. He wants to move in you and through you today. Isn't that awesome? Amazing. Stan. Oh, Stan. This song. That was quick. They thought I said stand, so the three of them. No, I said. So this is Stan.
I'm not wearing the pods on, down, the
rock. No, he's just a lowly Stan.
I had one of the distinctions of being actually, I think, the oldest. Actually, I'm actually 65. You're 62, 3. There you go. So I've actually been in the Christian realm most all of my life. I can't remember actually becoming a Christian. It's just something I was taught and I was raised in, and I've been all the way through. So I've been in Christianity longer than most of the people that were there have been alive. But my life has just made a change recently, as most people know. I've retired from work, and I'm at a phase where I've been sort of kind of figuring out where do I go next. And it's interesting. Most of what we did, I've done. So it's not like it's my first encounter in a sense. But I would encourage everybody to do this, because for me, I went with the intent of preparing myself for the next step. Because I'm getting that from the prophetic, that there's another step. And Kyle came up to me and he said, you haven't retired, you have just changed jobs. And from the minute I walked in and sat down, God said, you need to get this out of your life, because you're going to the next step. and this is in the way, and this will take it from you. And wow. And that was where he was going all the way through. And as he was going through some of this stuff, he said to me, he brought something to mind, and if I just a couple of sentences. During the Second World War, the Service Corps that took the supplies to the fighting men, they had a thing where as the trucks coming back from the front, past those going to the front, they would beat the horns twice, so beep beep. And what that was supposed to say is, having begun, keep on going. And so I felt like God was saying to me, beep beep, keep on going. You've been doing all this stuff, don't stop now. This isn't a retired, you just keep on going. There's another thing coming.
King Jesus, Thomas.
I had a good time. I enjoyed myself. I went there to see about the next step too, what Stan says. And I'm the same age as you, Stan. We were the old guys there. But it was fun. I had a great time. I got ministered to and got a few good words about going up higher, growing more in change, and just a deeper anointing. And holy God. I had a good time. And I had a bit of freedom to talk to people. My favorite time was lunchtime because I got to talk to people. And so I was just reading a few people's mail and making friends, and I enjoyed doing that. And it was just a wonderful time, and it was just, what can I say? It's, God was telling me certain things, and how he's preparing me, what he's doing, and the things I need to do to change more, and just to search my heart and to go deeper. I heard about Josh was talking about a man who prayed 8 hours a day. And he got changed.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, hey, maybe I'll try. But my wife had never seen me. But it was amazing. I'd recommend it to anybody. It doesn't matter your age. It doesn't matter who you are. You need it. You need it. It's time to allow God to change you and time to give up your holy cows that you have in your heart. Allow God to change and open up to them. Too many people keep closed, too many people hold back, too many people don't want to do nothing. And they just keep changing their mind. No, too much God. No, I'm not. You can never, never, ever, ever get enough God. You cannot. There's no way enough to be ready to have enough God. You need more, you need him every day, you need him constantly into your life. Without him, we're nothing. Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. So I just pray that God... I pray that you just... Everybody wants to get blasted by God, and yeah, goodbye.
Last week we spoke about had a kind of prophetic message that many of us are on the crossroads, and the Lord actually showed me this week. I was chatting with my pastor, and he said, "Son, you're at a he didn't say son, but you're at a crossroads in your life. You're either going to go for the high calling, or you're going to hold back." And I feel that again this morning, that I sense the fear of the Lord, and just that as a church, and just even as a church in our nation, and so many believers, they're really at a crossroads. If you just, do you want just a little bit of Jesus, or do you want to go for what God has for you? The scary thing is, we don't even know what that is. It's just more. It's just surrender. It's just daily. laying down your life and saying, God, do whatever you want to do in my life, right? So that's what we try to do as a church too, just, God, what are you saying? What are you doing? Anybody else before, we're going to close up in a few moments here, and I'm going to open my Bible for 1 minute. Really, it's going to be 60 seconds. Did everyone get to share that wanted to share? Good. Yeah. A lot happens. Open up your Bible to Matthew 28, verse 18. We're going to preach for just 2-3 minutes, and we're going to close up. We're going to give a call for anyone who wants prayer to be ministered to by the team here, by Joel and Jermaine, and the three step sisters. If you don't have your Bible, no worries. We'll put it up on the screen. Hallelujah. Matthew 28. Starting verse 16. The 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me." One thing we teach at the encounter and the forgiveness session specifically is that when you live in forgiveness, the devil can't touch you. A lot of believers walk around life, talk about the devil's attacking them, the devil this, the devil that. And it's kind of like, what about Jesus? See, when you walk in forgiveness, when you walk in grace, the enemy can't touch you. He can talk to you, but he cannot touch you. Jesus said, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go therefore," everyone say go.
Go.
"And make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all I've commanded you." I remember when I first... even before I started the church, I would preach in this vein. And this scripture got me kicked out of the church, essentially. Got me shut down. Because I was challenging too many people that you need to go and do what God is calling you to do. It's not enough just to talk about it, pray about it, meditate on it, fast on it, declare I have a calling. But you've got to actually take up the call of God on your life. Yeah. So this is what happens. This is why one of the reasons that we see people come, and I'll see people come from other churches, and part of me, I feel like sometimes I'm a bit of a doubting Thomas sometimes, because that's just been my experience, where people will come and they'll be like, "Oh, I'm refreshed." Bless you, brother, you're refreshed. And within 3 to 6 months, that refreshing feeling leaves them, and God puts his hand on them again and says, "Okay, now do you want to do something? Do you want to rise up in the calling I have for you? Do you want to actually be a part of the reality of the commission of Jesus in Matthew 28? People have accused me of, you know, just this thing where, "Oh, brother, it's just about loving God. Like, it's just, if you love God, that's all that you need to do is just love God. And if you just love God, and you don't need to worry about this stuff, condemns people. You don't have to tell people to go or challenge people to rise up with what they have. Just love God." And I'm all, he's kind of like, you don't even know what that means. Like, if you do this, it's loving God. Loving God isn't just about having this closet relationship with Jesus. It's about asking God to make you the man that you're called to be, the woman you're called to be, and pursuing that. See, the problem with that, I'll tell you the problem with that, it will kill you. It will kill you. Not in the natural. You're not going to die, for any new believer that doesn't understand what I'm saying. But it will kill your desire. Sometimes it will kill what you, your dreams that you've had in your heart. And God will resurrect new dreams.
It will cause you to lay down your life. It will cause you to sometimes lay down a relationship. I don't know how many people I've seen miss so much of what God has for them because of a relationship. And the reality of Matthew 28, the commission of Jesus, go and make disciples of all nations. This is what we're doing. This is what I'm believing for with all my heart, is that God would transform a nation. But I have realized, I just know it as I know my name, it is not going to be one man, it's not going to be even one church, it's not going to be a personality, it's going to be every saint beginning to labor, every saint beginning to say, God, how do I get in the mix? But you need to have, in the mix of church growth and life and just the production, for lack of a better word, of disciples of Jesus, how do I get in the mix? How do I contribute? The problem again with that is that you gotta die to live. That's the glorious thing about Encounter Weekend is you die. But now there's some guys that are alive to the next level.
Amen.
Glorious thing about this is you have access to Jesus 24/7. 365 days a year. If I can just encourage you for one moment, we're going to pray. You know, God is so good. He just knows you. And He knows your battles, and He knows what you've been through, and He knows your struggles, and he's seen the warfare. He's seen the failures before they even happened. He's seen the successes before they happened. And here you are now, each one of us, here we are now at a crossroads. Do we want the fullness of God? Are we going to go after everything Jesus has for us with these few moments we have left on this planet, which really aren't moments, or in this body anyway? One of the breakthroughs for me was, we don't do church to make people happy, we don't do church to make people comfortable, we don't do church to give people something to do on Sunday mornings, we do church to provoke people, to compel people, walk in your calling, walk in what God has for you, the time is short, this is what we do, because with you, apart from God's will, is empty.
Yeah, that's it.
It's empty.
Yeah.
There's not enough fun you can have. There's not enough things you can do.
Yeah.
There's not enough places you can go.
Yeah.
There's not enough things you can see.
Yeah.
There's not enough sin in the world to ever make you happy. All you have is Jesus. Yeah. All I have is Jesus.
Come on.
Yeah. Not enough sports I can watch. Yeah. He who has the Son has life. John 1:5. He who has not the Son has not life. So I just want to give an encouragement. If I want to pray for you this morning, we'll just pray on Mass and we'll be dismissed. And if you would like to receive some more prayer, we'll have our ministry team up here. And if you want to give these guys a little money, you can do that as the Lord leads you. But if you're just saying, man, I might not feel I'm at a crossroads, but if you are at a crossroads, and you're saying, God, I want everything you have for me. Just as a sign before heaven and earth, I want you to stand up right now, which I pray is everybody. Even if you don't feel you're at a crossroads, but you're just saying, God, I still want everything. I feel like I'm walking it in. God, I just want everything you have for me. And I pray it's everybody, but I mean, at the same time, don't do it lightly. But I just feel like if you're here, you got to be desperate, because... Thank you, Lord. And just as a sign, the international sign of surrender, just lift your hands up to God. I know you got heavy hands sometimes, and you're hungry and it's lunchtime, but lift up your hands to God right now. And Lord, we just surrender to you. Whatever you say, we will do.
Whatever you say, we will do. We just surrender to you, Jesus. We surrender to you, Holy Spirit. Just say that with me. Holy Spirit,
Holy Spirit,
I surrender.
I surrender.
All my life.
All my life.
All my time.
All my time.
All my money.
All my money.
All my gifts.
All my gifts.
For your glory.
For your glory.
Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
I am yours.
I am yours.
You are mine.
You are mine.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Bless you guys. Let's give Jesus one more head clap. It's all about him. We're gonna throw a little music and do the lights up here. And if you would like some prayer, we would love to minister to you, pray for you.